Welcome to r/ProRevenge. This is a story of someone getting back at someone with ProRevenge after being wronged. And today's story is, Landlord tries to keep us in a mold house. We get his place condemned by the city. So this is my first ProRevenge post. I've lived in a lot of awful places throughout my college years, but this was one of the big ones. It's pretty long, just to warn you. I had recently moved into a house with two other girls. It wasn't the best house, but seemed to look okay for a college apartment. One of the girls had a friend who had lived there before and told us that the landlord was sexist and kind of a D, but usually meant well, and it was decent rent. I'll be referring to him as Dumb A Landlord. We were all broke, so we decided to sign a lease. I should have realized the warning signs when Dumb A Landlord wanted to sign it in a Big Boys after he had just eaten dinner there, and the leasing agreement looking like he chopped it up from other pictures of lease agreements on Google. We also found this apartment as an ad off of Craigslist. Things were fine for a few months. I was living alone until the next school year would start, and wasn't home all the time, since I would go over to my boyfriend's a lot and sleep over. It was a split house with an apartment in the basement, and ours on the first floor. It wasn't long until I started to notice things happening. We'd get a good amount of rain, since we were in the Midwest, by some big local lakes, and it was springtime. We'd get a good amount of water, and the concrete steps to the house would consistently fill up with water I had to jump over, and it would disappear overnight. It also started to get a little bit of a musty smell in the house, and I had started coughing and sneezing all the time, but didn't know why. Soon the other girls moved in, and we started having some difficulties with Dumb A Landlord. He wouldn't tell us when he'd come over to check on the property. He said he did this to keep up on looks and mow the lawn, but he did it way too often for any of us to be okay with. He would argue with us about having a copy of our own lease. He'd yell at us to give him rent payments in cash, especially before going to his cabin up north with his girlfriend. But the biggest of all was that we were having problems with mold, and he did not care. For a while, we hadn't talked to the people in the basement apartment until everyone started having problems with Dumb A Landlord. We'd hear them arguing and yelling down below, about as often as we would upstairs. But they were in a hellhole. Everything they owned had mold growing on it. They had bugs everywhere. Earwigs, beetles, ants, you name it. They were constantly throwing away their clothes, dishes, furniture, even their college papers and homework, since it was all growing mold. They spent money on plastic bins to hold most of their important items, but even those would get moldy. We also found out that they were supposed to have another roommate down below, but she couldn't live there from her allergies to mold after signing a lease agreement. We also found out that Dumb A Landlord verbally abused her and her mother on the phone, to the point where they were crying, and she couldn't get out of the lease. She ended up paying for two places every month, so that she didn't have to live there, because he wouldn't let her break her lease, and didn't care. Upstairs wasn't as bad as the basement, but it wasn't good either. All of us were coughing more and more each month. We would wake up coughing in the middle of the night, and we were getting really sick. We tried to air out the house as best we could, but nothing helped. I ended up getting a severe case of strep throat so bad that every swallow I took made my eyes water and made me verbally make noise from the pain. I tried to ask the doctor I went to if he could prove that this was from mold later, but he unfortunately couldn't give me a solid statement on it. Me, being a vocal, neutral, good person, who was also going to school to be an architect, tried to explain to him what was going on in the house. No air circulation, his concrete steps and foundation walls were not sealed, so all of the water I'd have to jump over was most likely going into the basement walls, causing most all of the mold. We also found a few areas on the roof that needed patching, since we noticed some leaks among other things. And the basement apartment had cheap patio doors for their only means of entrance and exit, which would consistently be up against water when it rained, adding to the problem. Oh, smart Dumb A Landlord decided that we were all just girls complaining about silly things that didn't really mean anything. So he brushed us off and said we were fine, even though I had told him that I was learning about these things in school and knew what I was talking about. He wouldn't let us out of the lease as hard as we tried. So all of us girls in both apartments decided we would get out if it was the last thing we did. Then began researching all of the legal apartment and tenant information for our state and city to get out. We were paying for attorney fees, started taking pictures of the mold upstairs and downstairs that we could find, talking with several different city staff and police, and started compiling this into a nice document. After deferring my rent payment to get a copy of the lease agreement from Dumb A Landlord, we could finally take a look at our legal document and use that further to get out. We were also working with another landlord at a renting company in town, who I will call Good A Landlord. He was, thankfully, doing his best to get us out of the SH hole and into his apartment. Through him, we'd get all of the legal ins and outs of the renting business, and he would help us find a loophole. Then after months and months of arguments, money and researching, we found it. If we sent in a mold test to a research lab, and it was over the limit of what was inhabitable, we could get out. It was safe to say we had a pretty good idea it was over the limit. The test came back a few days later, and we sent that off to the city, including our nice document of pictures, statements, and leasing agreements. Not even 4 hours went by, and we got a call from the city. Our house was so full of mold that we were to move out of the apartment within 24 hours, and it was to be condemned. We were ecstatic. All of that hard work had finally paid off, although it was horrifying to know that the mold count was so high. The mold researcher who had been in the business for more than 30 years had not seen a place with higher mold count than this house. Yes, this included black mold. Fast forward to us happily packing up in our house, all of our parents getting us out together, us moving into the apartment that good A landlord kept open for us to move into, and poor old dumb A landlord sobbing in our driveway as we happily stacked boxes into our cars. Complaining that he should have paid more attention and listened to us, this was his girlfriend's property, and she's going to dump him. We all took a picture the next day, smiling in front of the condemned signs. It's still one of my favorite pictures to this day. Serves him right for not listening to his tenants. The second story is Crosspost from MC. Don't tell people how to do their job if you don't know how it should be done. So, backstory. I used to work at a factory who suffered severely under a director who wanted to make more money, with little ideas to how you run a factory or how you see through people trying to BS you to gain favor. One person in particular was notorious for licking buttholes. When I started, he was the boss for about a third of the production unit. And as it happened, he was also the guy who took over whenever my own boss needed time off, was out liaising with other companies, or otherwise wasn't on company grounds. This guy had a massive superiority complex and couldn't handle being wrong or having made a mistake. And just to make it better, he was also clueless about quite a lot of things outside the machine shop, where he was the boss. Safe to say, my partner and I really disliked him and made an active effort to work against his stupidity whenever he was our acting boss. So, as for the story itself, my partner and I made up the company's goods reception and quality control department. Basically, our job was to receive the goods and inspect that everything was in order. Correct amount had been delivered, no transport or production damage or mistakes, and then prepare the things for storage. But as you might expect, sometimes things weren't quite in order. Some things were unimportant and we just ignored them. Most things we send in to get them repaired, since most mistakes were fixable, and then send a bill to the contractor who were hired for the job. And a few things we discarded because they were broken beyond what we could repair. And this particular A-clown was allowed to greenlight things that my partner and I had sent in to get repaired. So one day the director comes out, with the head of productions behind him, wanting to know why a particular type of good from a particular contractor always got sent in for repair. And I do mean every time. And we explained that because purchase opted to use the cheapest place to get these things done. Quite frankly, one particular part was subpar, but it could be fixed, so it wasn't really a big deal. He wasn't happy with that explanation and wanted to get someone who knew of such things to have a look at it. Cue Mr. A-Clown himself, who takes one look at them and goes, "Oh, those are effing perfect, right as they're supposed to be." And director tells us to just send them on their way. My partner, a fairly temperamental guy, was furious, but we made a plan. And so A-Clown and director left, but head of production stayed behind. With every piece of good we received, we'd pull the schematics in order to measure if everything was in order or not. And then on this schematic, we'd write some additional information, purchase number, steel certificate, etc., so that we could easily trace everything back, should there be a problem. And for this particular thing, we drew an arrow to the part that was done incorrectly, wrote what the problem was, and approved by Mr. A-Clown, asked the production manager to sign it, and off the goods went. 5 minutes later, we got a call from storage. "So what's the deal with these goods? Why ain't they in the machine shop?" "Well, because Mr. A-Clown said they're okay, and the director is backing him up." Insert curse words. We then briefed him on the plan, and he was somewhat happy. So about 2 weeks later, our trap sprung. Our assembly unit, whom I'd already spoken to, needed these particular parts, and they received the ones that weren't made correctly. So they, of course, contacted their boss, who, according to plan, didn't contact my boss, since he was away, but the director himself, about how quality control had really messed up. Of course, the director came flying over, howling and screaming about our incompetence, to which my partner and I calmly asked him, "So it's about those specific parts creating this particular problem?" "Well, yes, you bloody morons." The director then called for Mr. A-Clown to come and straighten us out. Mr. A-Clown stood there all smug, expecting his next big promotion. But we called storage and asked our storage worker to bring up the pallet with the remaining goods and the schematic that had a very neatly approved by Mr. A-Clown, signed production manager written on it. The half a second it took him to realize that these goods that risked delaying the shipment and thus costing a small fortune in delays had been greenlighted by him was priceless. His face went from, "Oh yeah, I'm securing my seat as the next production manager," to "OF, I'm gonna get fired for this." He was later told to stay right away from the quality control department, and my partner and I, as well as our boss, celebrated with cake. And the last story is Summer Camp Bully Gets Double Dose. This took place many moons ago when I was in middle school. Every summer I was sent off to a two-week Christian summer camp out in the woods of Southwest Ohio. It wasn't the worst experience of my life, and it gave me a break from my dad, the drill sergeant. I grew up in a pretty small river town, so a lot of us went to the same camp, and two of those years included my bully from down the street. And of course, we were assigned to the same cabin both years. The first day of the first year, he fills, literally fills my sleeping bag with yellow mustard, mayonnaise, and ketchup. This is late July, and the cabins were rustic at best, so you can imagine the smell. I had to sleep on top of it, in my clothes, without a blanket all week. He was a big kid, think linebacker with baby fat, and would ambush me coming out of the showers every night with a wet towel whip, literally breaking the skin. Fast forward to the next year. With the help of my older brother, I came prepared. One small pouch of grape Kool-Aid, adjustable wrench, and a tube of Bengay. You see, he was always taking his shower in the morning before everyone else got up, and always used the stall closest to the door. On the first night, I took the wrench and Kool-Aid to the shower and waited for everyone else to be done, then removed the shower head in his favorite stall with said wrench and filled it with the purple Kool-Aid. Now, this wasn't the sugar-added jar of powder, but the 70s-only concentrate little packet. This is the best time to add that there were no mirrors in the bathrooms or cabins. We all proceeded to breakfast the next morning, and in usual form, he shows up 10 minutes or so behind us, as he liked to make a big entrance into the mess hall, which he did with a very purple face, as grape Kool-Aid concentrate stains the skin for at least a week. The place erupted. He was christened Grimace for the rest of the week. As you can imagine, he was a bit incensed, and while he suspected me, couldn't prove it. This led to more harassment. I informed him that if he continued, I would have to retaliate. He persisted, so out comes the Bengay. There was a drying rack outside of the showers for swim trunks, as we had free swim for the whole co-ed camp every day before dinner. I waited until that night and got up to go to the bathroom, swiping his trunks along the way and literally dousing the crotch of the liner in Bengay. Hung back up with well over 12 hours to dry, he took no notice, until of course he hit the water. Within a total of maybe 30 seconds, he was out of the water, clutching and clawing his junk, which only made it worse, and running full tilt for the showers. As I wasn't the only recipient of his harassment, and word had already leaked to my threat to him, I was a hero, and he didn't come back the next year. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.